वो ऑप्टिमल लेवल। Okay, now coming to a very, very interesting aspect. In companies where we have dedicated test departments or test divisions, we often see that the testers and developers are not co-located. So now coming to the, so we can reap serious benefits if we are co-locating the testers along with the developers. And of course, the product owners and other documentation people, all agile team, all the scrum team being co-located in one place. So what's the benefit we are going to go get from it? Of course, yes, it complies with the manifesto of agile software development, where we focus on the face-to-face interactions. But interestingly, one point is that we are going to see quick resolution of queries and open issues. So we all know that there are quite a few bugs which are in disputed state or which require clarification or which are kind of, you know, which need a lot of discussions and confabulations before we could move ahead. So in those type of cases, instead of doing a ping pong in or email or doing a ping pong in the test management suite, take QZ or TFS. Here, if people are located in the same place, it encourages people to actually do a face-to-face conversation and really sort it out then and there. So this will effectively reduce the number of open bugs in the system and will really expedite delivery. So this is a very, very subtle point, but I guess it will have a lot of productivity impact if we are able to do it correctly. Okay, now we are going to the topic of what are the innovations and adaptations we are looking at. This is again one of CRISPR's agile testing quadrants, where she has categorized what type of tests happening, what type of tests happen in a typical product or application setup, and then she has actually interestingly divided into four quadrants. So as you see, the quadrant one is the unit and component tests, which are done by the developer, which are typically expected to be automated. So these are what she calls as the technology facing test, and these essentially support the team. And then we have the functional test on Q2. So as we move up, the functional tests are typically the first level of black box verification done by the dedicated testers, and then here we are expected to have a mix of automated and manual tests. Then we go to Q3, where we do a lot of these negative testing, and where we do high-end, where we are doing system testing, usability testing, and then essentially where we are looking at end-to-end scenarios. So these are specialized tests which are often done by domain specialists, and these are expected to be done manually. Of course, there's some level of automation possible here. And then Q4 is essentially testing for the non-functional requirements. Be it load and performance, stability, durability, usability, etc. And then in today's world, where product vulnerability is also there, we are also looking at security testing. And apart from these, I would like to add on that we also have a lot of compliance and regulatory tests which we do, especially compliance to standards. You take a medical application, you need to comply with FDA standards, or you take a financial application, you need to comply with SOX standards. So these are compliance related also come in here. And then these again are extremely specialized, and then you need specialized tools to do that. As you also see, she has actually come up with a model where she calls the top two quadrants as business facing, then the bottom two as technology facing. And then the right ones, right two quadrants, Q3 and Q4, she calls it as critiquing the product. So essentially, one of the key agenda items in this particular discussion is that I would like to focus on what is happening in Q3 and Q4, and then look at the challenges of executing them within the sprints, and then look at what can be the possible adaptations which we can do in a typical in a typical software development setup. Okay, as we see here, in cases where we have high domain and or technological complexity, typically we find that there are dedicated test phases which follow the sprinting. So what it means is that after the sprints are over, you have a few months or few weeks where dedicated tests happen relating to, say, system testing or load and performance or the non-functional requirements, exploratory tests, and compliance to regulatory standards and guidelines. So what we are you able to hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, but there's a little disturbance over the line. Can you check?
I think it's not on my end because there's nothing changed here.
Okay, can you reconnect your headphone and microphone? I think it's gone. Yeah. There's no disturbance anymore. You can carry on.
Yeah, so what we see in the slide is that yes, we are talking of dedicated test phases where we try to do a lot of release level tests. So these are typically the what we saw as Q3 and Q4 tests in the previous slide. So the real challenge is that these tests which are done in the dedicated test phases often can unearth critical defects and then which can put the release in quandary. So if you find, say, when you are doing a load and performance test and you find a particular problem when you're doing find a particular problem which requires an architectural fix, it's not easy to do, and then it can actually put the release date under question, and it can have other big ramifications as well. Or you do testing in different environments, hardware or software, and then you unearth a particular problem which requires you to upgrade one of your system components, say a database or say a middleware layer. Then it really puts the whole project in a deadlock kind of situation, and then the management is also put in a spot of trouble because they are unable to honor the release date. As we all know, if you are working in a product environment, the release cycles are typically 6 to 9 months. And then if you get a surprise here and if your release is pushed back by a couple of months, it can really have a big impact on the marketability of the product. So that's where as I spoke in the previous slide, we are looking at doing some of these tests early so that we are able to mitigate that risk to at least, you know, to an acceptable extent. So depicted here, right now, most of the projects we are able to do the Q1 and Q2 tests without any problem within the sprints. The real problem is with having these Q3 and Q4 tests within the sprint. So that's what we have depicted in this particular slide.